been handed a double honor. Firstly, to be nominated as Slovenia's candidate to join the next College of Commissioners. And secondly, subject to your agreement, to take on the responsibility of humanitarian aid and civil protection under the banner of crisis management. As a Slovenian, I can most strongly relate to the fact that what is today the Director General for European Civil Protection and Humanitarian Aid Operations was created in 1992, also as a response to the wars on the territory of the former Yugoslavia. That same year, United Nations High Commissioner for Refugees set up a field office in Slovenia. Just before graduating from law school, I joined them to help take care of refugees fleeing to or through Slovenia. This gave me an opportunity for my first modest contribution to humanitarian work. More than a quarter of a century on, I'm before you as a commissioner designate. If entrusted with this task, I can assure you I will dedicate all my energies and almost three decades of experience in international and European fora to help alleviate suffering and provide relief to people affected by crisis, thereby confirming European solidarity, a value I strongly believe in. Honorable members, the EU is widely recognized as a responsible global leader in humanitarian aid, and we should take pride in that. However, in order to strengthen its global role, the EU must upgrade its capacities to be able to help more people in need swiftly and efficiently. Currently, the EU reaches out to over 100 million people in need each year, both inside and outside the Union. This directly affects the lives of men, women, and children, without discrimination on the basis of their nationality, race, gender, religious belief, class, or political opinions. It is reassuring to note that some 90% of Europeans support EU's action in both humanitarian aid and civil protection. I also know these endeavors have traditionally enjoyed strong support in this Parliament. I can assure you that I have every intention to work with you in partnership, to keep you informed, and to listen to your views and concerns. Honorable members, as much as my nomination means an extraordinary opportunity to serve the European Union, I'm also acutely aware of the plethora of challenges that the portfolio of crisis management entails. Today, ever more people around the world need humanitarian assistance. Almost 71 million people are forcibly displaced, and not only because of conflicts. Each year, some 70,000 people die, and further 70 million people are injured, left homeless, or in need in emergency assistance as a result of natural disasters. Next to casualties, the costs are high, and they continue to grow. Since 2010, natural disasters have caused over 13 billion euro of damage each year in Europe alone. What is worse, the trends we face are worrying. Humanitarian crises last longer and are more complex than ever before. Natural and man-made disasters occur with increasing frequency. More and more people are affected, including in Europe. By 2050, there may be over 140 million internally displaced people in sub-Saharan Africa, South Asia, and Latin America. How many of them will pick up what has been left to them and migrate to other places, including to Europe, in search of a better life? The resources globally available for crisis management do not match today's needs, let alone future projections. The funding gap is widening. Then there is climate change, rapidly transforming the risk landscape, adding more strain to an already strained system. In report after report, we learn more about climate change and its impacts. Rising sea levels, increasingly frequent and intense storms, longer periods of drought, more devastating floods. Life support ecosystems are under duress. But do we need another report to convince us of the gravity of climate change? The young generation obviously does not. They know for a fact that our house is on fire. To make matters worse, parts of the world hit hardest by the effects of climate change are also among the most fragile and least resilient. Countries of the Sahel and the Horn of Africa, to cite just a couple. This is the stark reality that I will face as Commissioner for Crisis Management. I realize that the picture I painted looks bleak, but I'm not resigned. If anything, I look at the challenges I have just outlined also as opportunities. Opportunities to do things better and differently, to build on what works and to fix what does not. I also realize that in many ways I can be grateful for determination and achievements of my predecessors, of highly motivated staff of DG ECHO, international partners, and most importantly, individual relief workers. Due to their tireless contributions, things by and large work. In addition, the EU is highly respected for its strict adherence to basic humanitarian principles of humanity, neutrality, impartiality, and independence. I intend to firmly defend these principles also in the future. Turning now to my priorities, I have said, if confirmed. Firstly, as Commissioner for Crisis Management, as well as the European Emergency Response Coordinator, my first goal will be to support people in need as rapidly and efficiently as possible, in full respect for humanitarian principles. In this regard, I will maximize the efficiency and effectiveness of our crisis response so as to reach the maximum people in need. This can only happen if we are able to work together better. In line with the mandate given, I intend to strengthen the EU's Emergency Response Coordination Center so that it can respond swiftly and effectively to a broad range of crises. Also highly important, if confirmed, I will strongly focus on advocating globally in support of international humanitarian law. In my contacts with state and non-state actors, I will firmly urge the preservation of humanitarian space. It is unacceptable that humanitarian actors are increasingly being targeted and their access to people in need regularly blocked. Secondly, in line with the proposed mandate, I intend to intensify EU's efforts to prevent disasters from occurring in the first place, while also strengthening our capacity to adapt to changing environment. In light of climate change projections, protracted conflicts and increasing instability around the world, we, the European Union and its member states, must work in an integrated manner. Our failure to do so risks jeopardizing the attainment of sustainable development goals, which is a collective responsibility. In this respect, I welcome the working approach envisaged by the President-elect, whereby each commissioner will need to ensure the delivery of the sustainable development goals within their respective policy area. On the side of prevention, I intend to work closely with the High Representative Vice President and other members of the College responsible for areas such as climate change, environment, and development. The aim is to ensure that disaster risk reduction becomes an integral part of our efforts to enhance the resilience of our societies and ecosystems, starting with the European Green Deal. Honorable members, humanitarian aid and disaster response must be seen as instruments of last resort. They should step in when all else has failed. Avoiding such failure must remain our first objective. When we have to mobilize humanitarian aid, our goal should be to depend on it for as short time as possible. In other words, We need to move people out of the emergency ward as fast as possible into recovery so that they can benefit from more long-term sustainable solutions. Here, security and development policies play a particularly crucial role. In fragile countries, especially those with protracted crises, we need to work towards a humanitarian development peace nexus. We must take local specificities into account, deliver the best possible assistance to those in need, while paying particular attention to the most vulnerable groups, like women and children. This will require new partnerships, as well as innovative tools. Here, in particular, I want to do more to empower local actors in delivering aid on the ground. They know the context best, they can work more efficiently, and they know what works. At the same time, we all know that despite efforts, not everything can be prevented. Recent events, including the deadly forest fires in Portugal, have shown that we must get better at preventing disasters, and we must be better prepared to respond when prevention fails. This is why I intend to vigorously pursue a strengthened implementation of RescEU, the Enhanced Union Civil Protection Mechanism, in close collaboration with the member states. We need reinforced capacities to deal with forest fires, acute medical emergencies, chemical, biological, radiological, and nuclear disasters. And here, I also count on the support of the European Parliament to help make this a reality. My third priority will be to enhance the visibility of EU's crisis management. I want to build on the strong support European Union's humanitarian aid already enjoys among European citizens. And I want to reassure them that every single euro spent in this area is euro well spent. Our most important audience should be EU citizens and beneficiaries. I will therefore place high priority on communication to them. Honorable members, I will not hide the fact that these priorities and objectives come at a cost. But rather than speaking of cost, I would prefer to speak of investment. In this case, investment in our common future. For this, I call on your support in securing the proposed 30% increase of the humanitarian aid budget as part of the next multi-annual financial framework. This is essential for delivering our ambitious agenda over the next 5 years and beyond. I would also value your continued support to ensure efficient and effective budgetary spending. For my part, I will guarantee that funding is disbursed to those in need transparently and on the grounds of sound financial management. In carrying out my responsibility, I will stand ready to work closely with both committees present here. If I succeed in winning your trust, I would want us to look back in 5 years' time and see that we have made a difference, that we have helped to alleviate the suffering of many, that we have contributed to more resilient communities and individuals, a healthier and more resilient natural environment, and to greater trust of Europeans in their future. Thank you.